This evening we're going to be having a conversation with Lorraine Morales Cox, who is an associate professor at Union College in the art department. She wears many hats in the art department, so I'm not going to try to go through all of them, but we're really delighted that we're going to be able to talk about the education of emerging artists, and we're also going to be able to talk about Hispanic artists, in particular, artists in the capital region, this being Hispanic Heritage Month. And we have been, we now have a tradition of keeping tabs on different artists in the area. So Lorraine, let me start by asking you, when did you first think that you liked art and that art was something that you wanted to explore?
Okay, that goes way back. That goes back to preschool, actually. I went to Montessori, and if you know the Maria Montessori method, it's very much like what your passion will foster it, and mine was visual. So from a very young age, I was sort of taught that making art and doing art was okay, and it was nurtured. My parents were always very supportive. I used to just make things out of just stuff I find, you know, I just collect stuff. So to me, I've always seen, I'm very much more sort of hands-on. So just making stuff and whatever I could find. It was the ninth grade, I had Mr. Winger in my, I took an art course with her, and she was, she had retired from doing graphic design, and we had an exceptional group of students in that class, and she was the first who said, you can actually make this as a job, like a living. I was like, really? And so I just made it really fun? She goes, yeah. So she was very supportive. She put us in various competitions. You know, we got awards. And then when we got to high school, we requested to have a double period to have 2 hours for us. And we went in an hour early to school to have a longer studio block with about six of us. And we loved it. And then when I got to be a senior, and I did Governor's School of the Arts one summer. It was the summer of my, I think, junior year of high school. And that was something in New Jersey. It was run by then Governor, his name, it'll come to me, Brendan Burns, I think that was his name, and that was great. So that was like 1 month intensive at Trenton State College with all the arts. It was like fame, so we had like people doing dance, doing theater, and then from that I made my portfolio, and I knew I wanted to go on to study art. I was thinking graphic design, so that I have this 9-to-5 job, and I went to Virginia Commonwealth, got my BFA. I did a dual degree in art history and studio, and what I really love are the critics. I love talking about the art, I love being around artists, but I knew my passion was to write about contemporary art, and with living artists. So in art history, most people are writing about artists who are no longer with us. I read a living artist, with Joe. Are you writing about living artists? Do you like your artists dead or alive? Like, I like mine a lot. So that led me to go get my PhD, because the one you can work in museums, but I really want to go on. If you, most people who do this, you go on to get a PhD to teach contemporary art. And so that's what I did. I went to the University of Illinois in Urbana-Champaign. And I also, so my specialty area is modern contemporary, so 20th and 21st century. But I also have a sub area, and my sub area is Latin American art. Mm-hmm. We had one professor who wrote her dissertation and her research on Frederick Edward Church, who did painting through the American landscape painter, but he went to Latin America, particularly to Brazil. And so she knew a little bit about Latin American art. So she had this one course she taught, and my friend Gisela Latore, who's now at Ohio State in their Latino Studies program, we basically were like, well, can we make our own thing here? So no one had really done this to make it. And so we were able to, you know, do independent studies. And we'll talk about that too, because there's still some sort of challenges in terms of what's being taught in higher ed when it comes to Latino art, culture, identity. And so, yeah, and then I ended up at Union College in 2001.
So what attracted you to Union College? Why did you make the decision to teach there?
So I grew up in New Jersey. I'd gone to school in Virginia, and then I went to Illinois. And so on the teaching market, you're sort of at the mercy of whatever openings there are. I was very fortunate that there was this opening at Union. They had actually reached out to me. They were looking to diversify the faculty as well, and they wanted so I applied and I interviewed, and I was very fortunate in my job talk that I had to do well. And so the way their timeline was working, I was in the first round, and then I had my son, so I couldn't take the job, and then they came back to me, you're still interested. So the way the calendar worked is it was before I would sort of go on the full market for a job. I was just delighted to get to New York, growing up in New Jersey. Mm-hmm. Just get me to the East Coast, because when you're in education, higher ed, you don't know where. You can be in anywhere. You can be in Nevada. Nothing wrong with Nevada. I'm to get closer to my family.
You don't want
Nevada. And to be 3 hours from Manhattan, 2.5 hours, I thought, what better place to be? So yeah, I came here with my husband at the time and my son, and yeah, been here 22 years.
And how is it teaching art, particularly art history? Is it like teaching any other liberal arts, or is it different from teaching studio art?
Yes. So students who take our courses, some are visual art majors, some aren't. To me, I see art as the ultimate interdisciplinary course. So I also have students that teach a course now in environmental and contemporary art. So I have a lot of students in sciences who are taking my class. And to me, I think artists are basically, giving us the way they see the world, and getting us to think about the world in different ways. So it helps if you've had some experience, like with a paintbrush when you're looking at paintings, but it's not necessary. And to me, I feel it helps if you've had some studio experience to really appreciate, right? Like when I took ceramics in college, I was interested in pre-Columbian art. And I was like, well, I gotta learn how to throw a pot. I can't study ceramics. So that's how
learn how to throw a pot?
I did. I did actually a minor in crafts. I ended up doing wheel throwing, and then I got into hand building, and then I ended up in the sculpture department. So sculpture and art history were like my combined degree. So I know the value of having to know the materials when teaching it, but so much of what I teach is also learning about the historical context, the religious. There's so much material that you get through the visual culture of art history.
Well, and we have multiple identities, so this question may be totally irrelevant, but do you think of yourself as a college professor or as an artist?
Good question. I think for me, doing contemporary art, I always feel like I have one foot in the art world because I'm writing about living arts, I'm doing studio visits, I'm going to exhibitions, it's work, and it's all the show.
Sure.
And then I have the other sort of foot in academic, where I'm publishing, and so to me, I've always sort of straddled those two spaces. I think of myself as a creative, in terms of the creative thinking, the type of projects I do. So I think I'm more as a creative, and I have this feeling of both the academic interest, so working with people making the art, but also sharing with students about the work they're making. And so it's interesting. I tend to gravitate more to like the art world or to just communities. I've been doing a lot more community-based learning and really sort of how the arts can impact, the social impact of art. It's a course I teach.
Yeah, which is a more contemporary topic to pursue. I have a number of artists who came up in the early 70s, and part of their focus was to have an impact on society in a social justice kind of way, not just to be famous or to have something hanging in a museum and so on, but actually to make certain changes in the ecosystem of the art world. And some of them have been able to accomplish that. But I think that that's like a more modern idea than, like perhaps an early 20th century idea or late 19th century idea.
I think today we hear the term artist social practice. And so more and more artists are doing projects that are participatory with the community and may not be producing like an artifact or some commodity that you can hang on the wall and sell. A lot of that comes from funding and grants or working with towns or cities. But yeah, I think certainly there is a kind of activist element, particularly in Latino art, because of greater representation and supporting their own communities. So there is, I think, something unique to particularly the fact that like Chicano grew out of the farm worker movement, right? So Yafoga, and so there is an interesting history that's unique, I think, to Latin America. Latino art in the U.S.
So what do you find intriguing about Latino art? You know, I mean, how is it alike? How is it different? What are some overarching concepts that someone who doesn't know much about Latino art might want to keep in mind?
Sure. Well, I have some works that you would like to see.
Oh, sure.
I have some. Oh, wait, Vera.
That's the one. Come on, come on.
We're in it. So while you're doing it.
But let's talk about it first.
Sure,
that
sure.
might be helpful.
I think for me, my own publishing is largely around artists, women of color. So a lot of my publications have been on that. I actually, going back to education, I want to do my dissertation looking primarily at artists of color. But my advisor at the time was encouraging me to do research on this German artist. He thought that maybe this, you know, Latina, writing just about Latino, that some of that would make too narrow my opportunities. And so I actually have come back to it because I've assumed that, but that thesis had a lot to do with the dissertation about art and identity. And myself as a mixed Latina, so my mom's Italian-Irish, my father's Puerto Rican, right? I'm sort of our part of me likes to be in the art world, part of me in the academic world, you know, part of me is an activist, part of this, I've always sort of lived in this hybrid space, so I'm always interested in hybridity and intersectionality, and so I think there's no better example of that. I mean, it exists in many different ways, but I think in Latino art, there's so many nuances to it, and that I'm really intrigued by that, and that was sort of what I wanted to share, to give some examples of some of the things that are happening.
Yeah. One of the things that I find is that there are some people who think Latino art is just one thing, and they're kind of like confused by the idea. There's not much, there's so much richness, and there are so many differences, and there are traditions within each Latin American country, you know, so that the tradition of Mexico is different from the tradition of Argentina. Or from the Caribbean, you know. So I'm always, one of the things I'm always saying is that it's all different. It's
right.
all different.
Yeah.
It isn't
yeah.
just one.
Yeah.
So I'm assuming
yeah.
that some
yeah.
of that will show us.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I think that's part of the beautiful thing and part of the challenge for people to understand.
Yeah.
You know, there are artists from specific, you know, have national identities, so say, you know, Mexico or Brazil. And sometimes those artists get spoken or recognized more because they have this identity from a national identity, where in the U.S., there's so many histories. So the history of Chicano art, so what's happening in the Southwest, the Neo-Ricans, right, what's happening in New York, different histories, like coming from, you know, colonized countries, right, or coming from, you know, what generation someone is, right? So you'll see, like, some of the artists, because there's such a range of experiences, that's why it's so important for scholarship and more exhibitions to give context to that, so people understand these differences. You know, I always say, people say, like, you know, the Latino vote. I'm like, well, what's the white vote this year? Like, it's, you know, it's sort of like there's such diversity. Like, Cuban Americans may vote different than they do in, like, Texas. There's different issues, right? There's border issues, there's different, you know, and class issues. So so I think it's important for that to have, for people to have a greater understanding of that context, but that takes, you know, people also understand their own history,
right.
not just getting others, right? And that's because you become, you know, for me, you become kind of a, I won't say a spokesperson, but you're able to better explain your work and your interests because you know your history and your background.
So what are we going to do?
So first, let's see how we go. Oh, it's like this, okay. So this is David Antonio Cruz. He's actually a friend of mine. I was just talking to him the other night because I was, you know, thinking about this show. I first saw his work at El Museo de Barrio, which is a wonderful museum. It's around 105th, I think, on 5th Avenue, not far from the Met. And some of his earliest work was dealing with themes of the jíbaro. And the jíbaro is like the Puerto Rican word for like a farmer or someone who lives in the country. But it's very much connected to Puerto Rican identity. I think it was Juan Muniz, who was governor, he used the outline of the symbol of the jíbaro hats as part of his campaign. And
Ruiz Muñoz Marín.
That's it.
That's
I wrote that paper way back when. But he's a queer Latino artist, and so he's also sort of mixing that up with the sort of machismo jíbaro, right, and looking more at sort of different ways of expressing sexuality. And so having him, you know, having him sort of like his pants are and having him with these, you know, the hats and the cowl. But his work has really evolved. He's an amazing painter, and he's been doing work, and I have some sort of text up there, but he's particularly interested in how communities and having a family beyond like your biological family, mm-hmm. and particularly looking at what we call like intersectionality, right, of his sexuality. His identity is Puerto Rican. He was born in Philadelphia, but of course in a very strong Puerto Rican sort of neighborhood. And so his work has these sort of wonderful sort of nuances to get us to think about that you're not just one thing. His work tends to get a lot of attention within the sort of the queer community. So sometimes it's sort of like you're depending on what someone sort of is looking for. But he's always very adamant to say, you know, I am a queer Puerto Rican. Mm-hmm. This is who I am. And these are some of these beautiful portraits he does. And also noticing how the difference of racial mixture, you know, he has them usually on sort of couches and in homes which have a sense of comfort. And it is about you build this sort of family, right? That's not your biological family because of the tensions there may be, right, in terms of people's homophobia. Margarita Cabrera, she's from San Antonio, Texas. She's particularly interested in labor. So that's another big topic, right, of the history of labor, both in the past, but also in terms of things having to do with border issues. These are soft sculptures she made that are based off of industrial products made in the maquiladoras, which are the factories side of Mexico, right on the other side of the U.S. border. These are largely made by women. They are largely, you know, working in not great work environments, not being paid well. But all these, so that these products that have like these threads and the softness almost express the exhaustion of the person who makes it. And of course, they're being consumed by Americans, right? And so there's ways in which these objects go over a border. The other work she's done, which is really interesting, is she's got this, she's still doing it, so it's a whole body of work, and she's taken the used immigration, border patrol.
Yeah.
She takes her old uniforms and she works with people in the community. They're all doing embroidery. These are largely either undocumented or Mexican Americans living close to the border who are using a traditional kind of embroidery techniques. Folk techniques from Mexico, and sort of illustrating their immigration story. And all of these cacti are ones you would find on the border. So she's got this really interesting thing going on in terms of like indigenous crafts, right, these border issues, these plants. And what happens is she's also an activist in that the people who work on these projects also get paid. And when her work sells, she's a very well-known artist, and when her work sells, they get part of the profit. So she's doing that kind So she's doing something different, mm-hmm. right? And so she.
Now that's one thing that I've shown a lot of artists from San Antonio because I lived in San Antonio for a while. So that's one of the things that I find interesting, that the kind of commonality of people working together in studios.
Right. And I think it really highlights the regional differences. Want to call it Latinx art, right? So it's not one homogenous thing, like you're saying. It's different things.
I'm not a keen supporter of Latinx as a word, but that's
trust me. I'm part of that. I like Latina. I sort of embrace calling myself Latina. I get the Latinx. Oh, I am also in that kind of generation of, you know. I like to say Latina. There's something of empowering about that.
You know, I like Spanish a great deal, even though it has a quite a number of issues of being a gendered language. But anyway, that's not the time for that discussion. We'll do it some other time.
So this is Liz Cohen, and even if you think of the name Cohen, you see, that doesn't sound like a Latina name. Her family's from Colombia. Her father was from an Orthodox Jew family from Syria. Mother Catholic, and they met in Colombia. So she grew up in the suburbs of Phoenix. So she has a really interesting, again, this kind of hybrid experiences. And she's in this really interesting project. It took her many years. She basically took an El Camino, and she combined it with a German car. I don't know if I have it there. But she kind of made this hybrid car, right? And so thinking about car culture in the Southwest or in California, the lowriders, But also the fact that she's a woman doing this work, and so she has these images, and here's sort of a good example of her sort of working on this equipment in this very sort of very feminine, like, you know, not what you would expect to see welding, right, with this sort of this white guy behind her. So she's also sort of disrupting our assumptions about femininity, masculinity. She's also interested in hybridity of these car culture, but cars coming from Germany, cars coming from, you know, they're predominantly, you know, U.S. cars that are sort of often sort of, you know, where they sort of jack them up and use these sort of really interesting, lots of the techno stuff they do, so cars crash and all that. This is Miguel Luciano. He's a Puerto Rican artist, largely based in New York, and he does a lot of projects like this one, in which he makes this pitagüeya, which is sort of in Puerto Rico. You would have these sort of bikes, and you have all the ices, so all the flavors of ice, right? And he actually, you know, rode this sort of, he has driven this sort of through various cities, and really sort of bringing sort of that kind of culture of a street vendor, right? And sort of bringing that sort of culture-specific object. He's also done things with bikes and sort of drawing attention to these sort of the issues around being a common status in Puerto Rico. And so the bikes are sort of, they're not good going anywhere. And so it's like US flags on one side, Puerto Rican flags on the other. So his work deals with a whole different sort of set of political issues, right? Particularly being Puerto Rican or coming from the Caribbean. And then you also add, when you're thinking about Caribbean, Afro-Caribbean, right? So there's also, people often talk about with sort of African-American art, sort of, that there is this, it's almost easier to understand black and white, you might say, right? That it seems that that's something people can, there, because there's such a commonality in that history, where Latina is so diverse, right? And so that's something.
I love the use of popular culture and the vernacular in, you know, I'm bringing it into focus into something else.
And I think that's also like these objects have their own story. And that sort of his work is very much about how objects and popular culture tell stories. I mean, his interest in the bikes comes from like the young lords in, that were sort of the Puerto Ricans in New York. And a lot of that sort of the bike culture, right, as a way to sort of get around. And same thing, people would pimp out their bike, right, or have all the flags on it. So, and I think that's the thing, is it's so important to have that context. And sort of talking to some of my friends and Latino artists, it's so important that this work gets exhibited and written about. Right, I think that's something where there's sort of a void right now in the scholarship. I think even my own experience was I was sort of directed to do where I'm a German artist. And so there really is a need for more scholarship on this to sort of flesh out these issues, the complexity of these issues. And I think there still needs to be some more progress in that.
Now you've mentioned the word hybridity a couple of times, and I think a lot of Latino artists are quite comfortable in that, in living in various worlds. How would you, do you agree, and how would you explain that, if you had to explain it?
Well, I think just saying a Latino, you could be Mexican-American, Puerto Rican-American, so already you're often connected to maybe a country outside the U.S. And if you're born here, your parents may be from there. You know, for me, it was my grandparents were from Puerto Rico. So there's already this sense of physical space coming from two, and there's two histories. And how with each generation, there's kind of more fluidity, sort of being. So I think for me, like, I don't like being white. I'm fluid. I think that sort of fluidness, particularly for Puerto Ricans, who literally go back and forth from Puerto Rico to New York. You know, it's like a bus. And it's sort of just, this, you know, it's this, the Puerto Rican community is very, you know, close, but it's also profuse. But you have concentrations, like the Neo-Rican, right, specifically. So I think hybridity is this ability almost to be, I wouldn't say like a shapeshifter, but it's being very comfortable not being like identified with one thing. And it becomes, that's just normal, right? That is sort of normal to sort of have a multiplicity to your identity. Which can, there's wonderful things about it, but it's also sometimes we want to claim you one or the other. You know, so I'm, you know, third generation Puerto Rican. So my father was born here, you know, I was born here. All the Spanish I learned in school, I had 6 years of Spanish. I didn't grow up speaking Spanish. You know, my father's of the generation where his parents didn't want to have an accent. 1940s and 50s, so they didn't want him actually learning Spanish in any formal way. And so people always say to me, like, you're not fluent. I said, no, I'm not, but my heritage, you know, like, I don't see myself as white. I see myself as Puerto Rican. And that's another thing people don't always understand. We have very different sort of backgrounds and experiences. And my family's very mixed. So we have, like, we might call Afro-Puerto Rican, like, it's a blend.
Yeah, that's very much many families in the Caribbean,
yes.
In Puerto Rico. I'm Puerto Rican. You know, you have all colors within one family.
Yes.
So it's like, you know, it's something that we're seeing. And this notion of hybridity, in one sense, also feels, of course, to me like remnants of post-colonialism.
Yes.
And that's one of the issues that I think a lot of artists are dealing with, colonialism. What does it mean to have lived or to be living in a colonial system, and that is still the case for some of the artists, particularly for Puerto Rican.
Yeah. I think because there is this kind of exclusion, the sense of like you're not from here, or it's the ways in which racism is sort of institutionalized in general across so many different areas, that there's this sense of you're because of that environment. You belong here, but not here.
Yeah.
And I think that's, so part of that is sort of beyond the sort of colonial history and just racism in America.
And imagine when you are a Latino artist and suddenly you also take on upstate New York artists.
right.
Which is like
an
identity that is quite different in many ways. So tell me how you connect with the students that you have, the Hispanic students that you have. And what is it that you see in them that may be different from your run-of-the-mill students? Although there's no run-of-the-mill student, but
Well, fortunately, UNU has gotten quite more diverse since I've been there. It was not very diverse when I came there 22 years ago. And so there's been a lot of sort of inroads in that sense. But it's also about what is being taught. Right, and how do we look at Latino history as part of American history? And so I'll get students, particularly my Latin American art course, which is like 80%, you know, BIPOC students. And to me, it's like this dream course, right? Because it's like this whole mixture. And I always feel like I can be more myself. You can see I'm very expressive. And for some of them, they haven't heard a lot of this history. So in that sense, they're really sort of soaking in something they have not had the opportunity to really sort of learn about. In the terms of our art majors, you know, it's not a huge number of art majors. You know, we will get sort of a student of color here and there, but it's, again, because you're also dealing with family expectations, right, that you go to, studying art is not going to be a legitimate job, even though creativity is an incredible asset to have. It's not just about being a professional artist. So there's sometimes that sort of convincing of people to say, you know, but studying art has some wonderful attributes to it. And so family expectations sometimes, particularly a lot of my first generation students are first gen, so they're also dealing with those sort of challenges.
Yeah.
And so I think there's wonderful opportunities for them to sort of learn more about this history. But at the same time, they're still underrepresented. And, you know, talking to David about how important it is to build your communities within that community, particularly if you're, you know, even if you're like an art school doing an MFA. You know, because you're still, a lot of the faculty are not as diverse. The students are becoming more diverse, but not so much of the faculty. I mean, it's happening, but as you can imagine, when you're a professor, you teach for like 30 years, so it takes a while. When you only have 10 people, that, you know, people are there for their whole career. So that's sort of, I think, with my students, and I really enjoy it. I really enjoy working with more diverse students, and I love just the diverse class. We have some amazing conversations. We had a really good conversation about consumer culture and the oppressed and, you know, the oppressor and how that affects.
So do your students, your Latino students, come from all over the states, or are they mostly concentrated in some cities?
Yeah, I think, you know, we certainly get a lot of students from New York City, but admissions does a really good job of sort of recruiting from other areas. So we've had a growing number of students from Texas, Chicago, California, LA. So there is sort of greater diversity geographically, and right there, then you also have those students seeing the differences between themselves, right? Because of, you know, growing up in, like, say, Texas versus growing up, you know, Puerto Rican in New York City. And so they're just learning a lot just from being around each other, you know, having that sort of understanding of how their culture, what the similarities, what the differences are.
And do you and do they feel that having an academic education, having training in the arts is useful, mm-hmm. is something that opens up their mind or opens up their creativity?
Yeah.
Is that, do they think of the work that they're doing in an academic setting as a positive thing, or is it like, oh, you know, something that has got nothing to do with my life?
Right. Well, I think because we're a liberal arts college, so students have to take a range of courses for like our general education curriculum. I think for me, communicating to students that in the outside world, creativity is so valued these days. You have to be able to look at things from multiple perspectives. You have to problem solve using your creative mind. So like I was saying earlier, it's not just about I can draw, I can paint, but that process of looking at something and going from like the 3D to the 2D. So I have students who are engineers who love taking art courses because it's training that other part of their mind. And I think when students begin to realize that this is about a way of thinking and seeing, you know, how you see the world. So people go into marketing, advertising, product design. We've had students go into fashion. I teach a business of art course just to expose students to the range of possibilities that they can do with an art degree, though Union is not a BFA, it's a BA. Mm-hmm. And we do get some students who go on to MFA, not many. You know, they all know it's like 1% of students are actually maybe gonna, you know, want an MFA, and then 1% of that they can be just making art. So it is about how I apply my interest in creativity in other ways. And I always see those opportunities growing and growing and growing, particularly the ability to adapt, to change. Right, to be comfortable being uncomfortable. You know, art's about iterations. We don't fail. And
well,
some
you know,
there, fail. We
there was
fail.
A time in the 60s and 70s when having a liberal arts degree was really more useful to you in becoming a corporate CEO than having a business degree, because it did provide you with a broader perspective. So having art now, in a sense, might be a way of providing students with a way of creating, of seeing problems in a different way, you know. And I'm curious also about the non-Latino students. How do they think of these classmates who are Latinos? Do they seem to have an appreciation for the work that is being produced, or do they look askance at the work that these young people produce?
That's a complex question, because there's things that are like inside the classroom, outside the classroom. I think this generation thinks much more inclusively. So if you were to ask me that question 20 years ago, I'd probably give you a different response than now.
Well, that's great.
Yeah, so that's the good thing, is that these students are growing up, hearing things like Black Lives Matter, understanding institutional racism, mm-hmm. things that I didn't grow up hearing, right? I just felt different, I think there's the reasons for them to appreciate others has a lot to do with kindness, you know, I think students today, I mean, you're still obviously gonna have, you know, students who are privileged, who aren't privileged, you know, first generation students versus someone who's like their fifth generation college students. You know, there's all other like intersectional factors that go into it. So I don't see it as like, you know, they see themselves as classmates. And I think this generation of students are curious to see how someone sees the world different than themselves. They're much more open to that.
Right.
So, and I think they begin to realize like it's a real asset to be in a diverse classroom.
I met yesterday a couple who were in advertising and brand development and so up until their 50s, and then they decided they wanted to do fine arts. And so they studied fine arts. Yes. They went back to school, they went back to prep.
Wow.
And they're painting and sculpting, and you know, it must be in their 70s, and And I thought, gee, they're living what some of the younger people are supposed to be living, namely that you will go from one kind of career to another career to another career. But these are older individuals who took it to heart, you know, and they're so happy. They look so happy. They look so comfortable being artists and calling themselves artists and not just marketing people.
Right. Yeah, and I think that's the thing. I think people are like, for me, I was like, I'm new into art and I'm gonna be graphic design because I can get a 9-to-5 job because my parents are gonna pay all this money for me to go to school and I have to get a job. But then I followed my passion. You know, I mean, I had to go to school for like another 8 years after I got out of college, but you know, I'm here, my family and friends, when I tell them, not so much now, but I travel a lot with my research, you know, over Europe, and they're like, wow. I'm like, well, yeah, I didn't like get a real job until I was 30, but I now have this job that allows me opportunity to travel. So it's a different lifestyle, you know, but I think it's great that they've been able to sort of do that, and probably because they've had the financial means after they retired, that helps, but it's great for people to see, have that kind of longevity and appreciation of wanting to make art. That's awesome.
Now, I noticed that you are involved in all kinds of things at the college. You do faculty development, you are involved with a digital project, you're very interested in feminism, you write about all kinds of subjects. So what other subjects are you thinking about now?
What
other projects
do
you have?
Yeah. So I've been a lot more into what I call creative placemaking. So 2 years ago, there was a Northeast Mid-Atlantic Creative Placemaking Summit, and different cities could submit proposals to be the host city. And I sent a proposal. I was able to raise a good amount of money through various organizations, and Schenectady was the host site for that. And so for me, I'm particularly interested in the social impact of art. And so creative placemaking is about how can art support community economic development, which is sort of interesting if you're dealing with like developers and like nonprofits. And so it's an interesting sort of space to straddle. And so I teach a course on this. We spent a lot of time going into the community, meeting different, so think about feminism. So we went to the YWCA, which is domestic violence shelter in Schenectady. And the students got to do a simulation about domestic violence. It was very powerful, very impactful. And at the end, they're like, every student should do this. And so they begin like, oh, I didn't know there was a domestic violence shelter here. I didn't know there's issues around human trafficking. Or I didn't know there's this great organization doing an urban garden. And so they begin to see that, and they also develop projects that have to do with what are some creative ways to bring people together? You know, how can you build community? And so that's become my interest, and so I'm what they might say a scholar of practice, so I'm not publishing like I used to, but I'm very active in the community, meet a lot of people, I'm also interested in entrepreneurship, and that's another important piece for me as well, particularly, supporting young entrepreneurs, entrepreneurs of color, who may not have the resources or the experience or like parental support to navigate that. So to me, I see myself as part of the community and doing what I can to sort of uplift the community, develop our partnership with the college. You know, UN's had a history of sort of this, literally has like a fence around it. So how are we sort of getting and seeing ourselves part of a broader community? So that's where my current interest is, and really supporting students and understanding the application of creativity.
So you've seen union change in the last 20 years, 14 years. You've seen the arts in the capital region go through changes, I'm sure. What's your sense of where the arts are in capital region, and do you see any place where Latino artists might find a hospitable place there?
Right. I think there's definitely a greater sense of community for all artists in the region. I think there's particularly around the whole what's happening with muralism in the area, which actually has a long history back to Mexico and Diego Rivera, and so. So that has definitely brought some sort of new voices to public arenas. I think I would love to see more galleries like your own. I think it's really artists to be able to sell. And so having galleries are so important, having exhibitions. And we have some really nice venues in the area, everything from our colleges, you have New York State Museum. So there are those venues, but having the curators to, curate shows with local artists is so important. I would love to see more of that. And so I think artists have to build their own community. And you go to art events, like we said, probably been in similar spaces. So that's really important to have that. I don't know of any kind of critical mass of Latino artists in this area, right? I think there is diversity amongst the artists, but so that I think having those artists also connect to colleges, to Latino studies programs, right, to people who are interested in Latino culture, not just the visual part of it, is a way to sort of build that community.
Well, we're certainly not like LA, and we're certainly not like New York, and, or Miami, or even Chicago, where you do have a mass, not a big mass, but you do have a multiplicity of Latino artists. And they know each other, which is really fantastic. It would be great if visual artists, installation artists, and public art artists would be able to do the same. There's a great deal of richness in the background that you bring, Lorraine, and it's great that you're able to talk about these various communities in a way that one knows that you've been there and you have seen it.
I love advocating for it too. So thank you for inviting me to be here and talk about this and see my myself as a resource for people.
So are you practicing anything? Are you sketching or making ceramics?
Yeah, because of COVID, I've been drawing a lot of sketchbooks. I love working with natural materials, so we have we purchased a small log cabin during the pandemic, and so I've been collecting birch bark. I've done classes with students at our Kelley Adirondack Center making birch bark picture frames.
Oh, great.
We did an Adirondack mini term, and it was co-taught, and I did sort of arts and culture, and we did some nature observations. I've become much more interested in nature again. I had as a kid growing up, and so I'm really interested in sort of holistic, creativity in nature, like music in nature, sound healing. I think there's a lot of interesting things happening in that space that I'm very curious about, on a personal sort of level, but also, my vision would be to do some sort of artist residency at the cabin, to the bringing woodworkers. Love working in wood. I want a studio. I want to make more of a space to have some.
The problem with some of the residencies is that you have to commit yourself to a long term, a couple of weeks or whatever.
Right.
But if there were places that you could do a residency of a couple of days or a weekend or whatever, I think that would be, I suppose it's along the lines of a pop-up exhibit.
Right.
We want things that are short term,
right,
and nonetheless that have an impact,
right,
on what we're thinking. Your interest in nature in part is, there's an American tradition on that, but it's also that we're talking now more about climate change and sustainability. And I think that we're seeing that in some ways the arts have to be involved in that. They can't just be observers.
Right.
They have to come up with some solutions, come up with some vision.
Yeah.
Do you agree?
Yeah, I'm actually teaching a course right now on environmentalism and globalization and contemporary art. So today we're actually covering the origins of the environmentalist movement. We also talk about consumer culture, behavioral practices. I'm also very much, for me, it's you learn from doing. And so when I first designed the course, I thought, well, instead of me just sort of talking about all these different artists making art about environmental issues, I'm going to have the students do it. So they work in teams for 7 weeks. Next week the teams will be formed, and they do a creative intervention on campus to bring awareness to an environmental issue. So it's also that sort of social art practice where doing something creative that also becomes participatory. So students have done things to raise awareness around the water and meat consumption, which is, I find it fascinating and scary, the data that they sort of come up with. since I've gone private, they had like a dinner table because they started reading about pharmaceuticals ending up in like drinking water and how that gets into food systems. And so they start to see, you know, I start the class with a quote from one of the first times I taught it, a girl named Julia Meyer in 2014. She was in environmental studies policy, one of our first students to go through that program. And she said, I didn't know art could be a game changer on environmental issues. So yeah, I would love to see more of that in this area as well. You know, I think especially like being so close to Adirondacks, but also urban spaces. You know, we talk about urban gardens, but how can artists be more involved, say, in that? And some are, I'm not saying they're not, but I think there's a lot of more opportunities for artists to bring awareness to environment, like lack of trees for shade, you know, in urban spaces. And finding creative ways to draw attention to that. And it, again, it's more that participatory than it is like making a painting about a tree. That's one object, right? Something that's more in the public sphere, in the community. Or a mural, there's murals I can also address it as well.
One of the things that I see is that there's not only the farm to table movement, which is of course terrific, all of these farmers markets that have arisen in the capital region, but also there are a number of farms that are making themselves available to people to stay overnight or to come and do a number of things. Or, and I see that in Puerto Rico also. You know, there's a whole generation of college graduates who have decided that they want to grow stuff in Puerto Rico, primarily as a result of Maria, you know, the Hurricane Maria, the way that it devastated the opportunities for people to have their own food. So I'm looking forward to seeing more farms here, and perhaps how they might get involved with art.
Yeah.
How could that take place? Obviously, we have sculpture gardens, but and we're kind of happy with that. But what else could happen in a farm with regard to art? It's great talking with you.
It's great talking with you.
And I'm really very happy that you've given us this time. Is there something you wanted to say that I did not ask you?
No, we covered a lot. I think the one thing is we're going back into in terms of how do we support artists, particularly artists of color, Latino artists. You know, a lot of it is the responsibility of curators and writers to be writing more, and for artists who, once they get at a certain status, to make sure they're advocating for the artists who are still coming up. I think that's a really important piece to all of this, that there has to be that sense of building community, but sort of also knowing to support these younger artists who, when these artists who are now sort of established, well, they didn't have any role, they had to sort of do it themselves, but now they can really impact and bring up other artists. And so that's just something I would want to make sure, you know, people are aware of, that we need to make sure we're doing that. People asking institutions, are you going to do an exhibition of Latino artists? Are you going to do an art show that deals with more diverse issues? Are you going to do a show that deals with migrant issues, especially right now, right? So I think the public has more of a voice than they realize, that you don't wait for the shows to come to you, but you actually advocate and ask those institutions, what are you doing to do to better represent all the people, you know, in this region, in the U.S., and that diversity, that rich diversity, and not just looking at this ocean political lens, you know, that's part of it, but it's really about how can you grow great appreciation for diversity of artists and art forms.
That's a great idea.
Might I ask a question?
Oh, yes, sure. Yes, sir.
If anybody else wants to ask one. I really like the Luciano piece, and I like the Liz Cohen before it. They're at odds with your talk about nature at some level. So I'm curious to learn, on the internet, obviously, but where can one see Cohen's or Luciano's work, and why did you choose it?
Well, I think for me, I was sort of showing the range of the regional differences and the sort of the back, you know, the different sort of context of, to show the breadth of Latino art, that it's not just because there's such a diversity of history and culture. And so this is like one area that I'm sort of interested in and writing about. And a lot of these, it's just, I've been to exhibits, they're friends of mine, you know, it's amazing what you find online and you can just research. I always tell like my students are doing research, print the name of the artist and put exhibitions, because then you might find a group show with other artists, or maybe a Latino show that has other Latino artists, you can learn about them. So there's a lot that's really sort of accessible. But, you know, art addresses a range of issues. This was sort of to show, right, that diversity within Latino community. But I think when it gets into environmental stuff, it's very sort of mixed, you know, because this tends, depending on the subject, this leans more towards issues of identity, social issues. There are plenty of artists, I want to make sure people know, that are, you know, Latino artists who are making art that's not anything, it's abstract.
Yeah. Talking about more academic,
yeah.
Perhaps.
So not to think that you have to make art about identity issues. And that's something that's a challenge for artists too, when they feel some pressure, they have to make work about their identity.
And you can move from one style to another style, which is often what happens in a long career.
Yeah, yeah. Does that answer your question? Where you wanted to
sort of, yeah. I didn't hear you talking about Luciano or Cohen very much, you know, and you went to a more general topic.
Yeah, yeah.
You'll have to read a little bit, and perhaps I can provide something.
Well, thank you.
Yeah, because I mean, I didn't show, I mean, I could, you know, this is, a lot of his work has symbols, like the Jíbaro that uses the
That's
knife.
That's fascinating.
Yeah, that uses the knife is associated with Jíbaro and some farmers, right? So this is really interesting sort of mashups. Yeah, his work's really great, and he's got whole bodies of work, you know, that are all, you know, I told you I'll bring a few slides. I could do a lot. But I heard your research.
Slides can put you to sleep sometimes.
Certainly, Almost on the Body is a great venue in New York City, which is always showing Latino artists, right? They have biennials every 2 years of sort of emerging artists. That's how I found out about David Antonio Cruz. I saw his show in 2006. And who are you? Let's talk. And it's interesting, like I wrote his recommendation for Yale for his MFA. So these artists that were like younger, younger, like grown up together now, you know, and I had this big solo show of Philadelphia.
And I think the Albany Public Library has a question.
I was wondering, like, where you might, and I might have managed to make.
I know. I'm not
talking. But where you travel to see the art. Do you travel? You said you go to New York City.
New York City is definitely one of the, I'm not traveling as much, but I have been, I used to go to a lot of conferences, and so whatever conference I go to, I check out the art scene. Mm-hmm. So when I was in San Antonio for, I think it was an American Studies conference, I found that there were any openings. So whenever you like go to a city, mm-hmm. just to find out, because I love going, there was an opening, so already I got exposed to so many local artists. It was Pace, the Pace family,
they have
a residency in San Antonio, and I happened to be there when there was openings going on. So a lot of it's sort of specifically going to see something, but a lot of it is just wherever I go, I'm always like, what's going on? Is there any, openings are always great. Mm-hmm. So if you're going, like Thursday, Friday nights, usually when you have art openings. So if you want to plan a trip and find out, like does the museum have an opening, or what shows are at the museums. Whenever I visit family, I go to museums.
Sometimes it's a neighborhood. Blue Star in San Antonio has a lot of little galleries, you know, in the south.
Yeah. The big thing I go to now is mainly the art fairs, Art Basel, Miami. So these are like these huge sort of venues. They're in the main convention center. There's all these satellite fairs, and you have galleries from all over the world. It's like one stop shop. I mean, it was really sort of, it's created design for collectors to also go one place and see art from all over. But for others, it's just go to see the art, right? I'm not buying it, I'm writing about it, or I curate as well. I didn't mention that, so I curated a show last year on fiber-based art, which gets back to your question earlier about nature. And so that exhibit was artists who were using like organic materials, they were using fibers, but they were making sculpture. The theme was about trauma of the earth, but also trauma when makes work about domestic violence trauma. So my interests are always around sort of issues social justice, kindness, like what could we, you know, and so how, and kindness to the earth. That's something I've become more interested in personally, but also teaching this class, the show I did last year. So I have a range of interests, but that's certainly more where the direction I'm
going. No, there's no denying you do have a range of interests. One just needs to look at your little bio.
Yeah, I'm not one thing. I mean, that's the thing. I'm not, and that's how I kind of grew up. It's sort of like, there was never any pressure to be one thing.
So I want to mention that in Troy there is an event the last Friday of every month, which is called Troy Night Out. And the gallery, my gallery, is going to be open for Troy Night Out at 4:30. We're going to have Hispanic artists in a new space. It's a hallway. And so we're calling it the entry. And there can be a couple of pieces that can be shown there. And I thought, why not? You know, use a space in a creative way.
Yeah, absolutely.
So anybody who wants to come to Troy the last Friday of September, you're invited, 1913 Fifth Avenue. And the phone number, just so that you have it, 518-274-9377, in case anyone wants to find out more information. And I think we're a little beyond what we were supposed to, but it's okay. It's all good. It's all good. So I'll say goodbye at this point, but hasta luego, you know, which means until next time.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you, Lorraine.
You're welcome. Thank you for having me.
Okay.
Thank you for coming.